why TB being gender biased? Most of the cases, when we see the graph, like, it is most prevalent in the male, not in the female. I mean, with the increasing age also, the chances of getting a TB in a male was more than the female. So is there any specific condition which male have and the female don't have, which promote TB in males?
It's a very good question. Actually, nobody knows the answer to that. Earlier, it was thought that it was health-seeking behavior and all that, but it's not, because at the community level, population level, you find the difference. So it's not that more men are coming to the hospital. In fact, the studies have shown the opposite, that women seem to come up earlier than men to the hospitals. So something to do with hormonal, because post-menopausally, you see the rate in women going up, but how estrogen is protecting, we don't know. Up to puberty, it's the same, the rates in young boys and girls. And then in the reproductive age group, there's a gap, and post-menopausally, the rate in women starts going up, though it doesn't reach the rate in men. So this is a very good question.
I mean, and because there was a recent study which says, I mean, there's a viral disease in which men are more prone to death than the women, because the virus chooses women to be a dormant or a latent state because they will perpetuate in the next generation. So is there a certain kind of thing which will be like prevailing in TB also?
I doubt it, because TB doesn't kill quickly, and in fact there's such a long gap between infection and reactivation, so I don't know if it's a survival mechanism or if it's linked to something in the milieu. I haven't come across any recent work that's been looking at this. This is true for most countries in the world, this epidemiology, except interestingly for one or two. In Afghanistan, there doesn't seem to be much difference between men and women in rates. See, earlier it was believed that it was because men were outside and more exposed, and maybe exposed to more smoking is more, alcoholism is more. So some of the risk factors are more in men. But that doesn't seem to account for all the gender differences.
So for a disease like TB, which has already become a mammoth for us to tackle, shouldn't we all, when it comes to coming together, shouldn't it be like a whole piece of cake divided into number of problems and then be solved, rather than each individual study happening in pockets? And what are the roadblocks to that kind of a strategy being implemented?
Yeah, I think that's a very important point. What's been happening so far is that people write individual grants, they get funded for that particular small piece of work, and so it doesn't add up too much. So the TB consortium is actually trying to address that problem. But even before that, we had the system, ICMR, DBT and the NIH had come together to set up those cohorts, which I didn't give you details about. But essentially, those cohort studies are important to answer these kind of basic questions about a disease. You know, whether it's diabetes or whether it's TB, you need a set of individuals who've been followed over a period of time and samples collected periodically to answer some of these questions. Whether it's to do with, you know, who are the people among household contacts, some get TB and some don't. And how do you distinguish the two? What are the factors, maybe genetic factors or other factors? So in India, we had not really invested a lot in those kind of studies. It's been a challenge for researchers to do long-term cohorts. There are a few very famous cohorts in India. One is called the New Delhi Birth Cohort. That was started when I was doing my, even before I was doing my MD. And so today, those children who were born in the 70s and 80s are obviously 40, 50 years old, or 30, 40 years old. Similarly, there's a birth cohort in Pune, but it's a struggle to keep such cohorts going. So we need to invest more. Like what you're saying is, the science agencies must come together and say, okay, if you put in the basic structure to collect all this data, then researchers can come in with their questions and start answering.
Okay. No, like we know a lot. We know the host path. We know the bacteria a lot, like a lot of genome sequences. We know the antigens. So if you just divide the problem that these many groups will now target maybe the genomic method or biproteome method of vaccine, some people can take up the drug problem. I don't think that it is unsolvable. If you come together, not individual pockets, and then the industry who wants to take it later would say that I don't believe in this data because this is lagging. So if everybody comes on one platform, looks at data continuously, then I think it is possible.
No, you're right. I think that's a great suggestion.
This is not actually a research question, but just want to know, I mean, why can't we have the certain guidelines to diagnose a TB? Because most of the time, I know the case where a person was misdiagnosed. He was suffering from sarcoidosis, but treated for TB because the symptoms for sarcoidosis and TB are very similar. So distinguishing between both of them is quite difficult. So I think there should be a certain guideline.
There are guidelines for diagnosis and treatment, but TB is a disease which is mimicking many diseases. And also, if you have straightforward pulmonary TB, it's relatively easy to diagnose because you can take a sputum or a bronchial wash and look for the bacteria. But there are forms of TB, extrapulmonary so-called, which occur in the bone, in the brain, in the abdomen, any organ in the body. Much more difficult. You can't always get a tissue. So people have to use radiology and a lot of other supportive tests to diagnose TB. So a lot of misdiagnosis happens. And sarcoid is one condition where they're very, very similar. So it's not that there are no guidelines, but the guidelines have their limitations, because the only way of definitively diagnosing TB is to show that the bacteria is there, whether it's a molecular test that you're doing or a culture test that you're doing. In the absence of that, you're forced to use these other things, radiology. In children, that's what happens. You get a positive bacteriological test in less than 5%. So in the remaining, it's the clinician, the pediatrician who makes a diagnosis. So this is a problem with TB. So sometimes diagnosis is delayed or missed. Sometimes there's an over-diagnosis.
Delayed by 2 or 3 months, because till the time doctor think like this is not sarcoidosis, this is TB actually, or this is TB,
that
this is not sarcoidosis. It takes 2 or 3 months because it's totally dependent on how patient behave or patient's progress on disease or, I mean, is effect to the medicines he or she getting. So yeah, it actually delays the treatment.
But it's one thing to have guidelines, another thing for people to follow them. So there was a study that was done where they had these mystery clients, you know, going to doctors and pretending to be TB patients and giving classical symptoms of TB, like I'm coughing for the last 2 weeks and things like that, you know, acting. Very few doctors ordered the right tests.
Yes, sir.
So they looked at allopathic doctors, they also looked at quacks, and they looked at other kinds of health practitioners. Most of them gave a prescription of antibiotics, you know, and then they start shopping every time the patient then goes to another doctor to see if they get better. That's why that study showed it takes about 3 months, 2 to 3 months for a person to get a diagnosis, even with a straightforward pulmonary TB. Whereas in the government sector, it's much better, it's much more standardized, and people would be offered the right kind of diagnostic test, but people don't often come to government center initially. 80% of people who have a symptom will first go to a private practitioner. So getting, and our private sector is very huge, very variable, very heterogeneous. So getting all of them to adhere to some kind of standard guidelines is challenging.
Why can't we go for the PCR technique for diagnosing the TB strains?
We are
directly.
We're moving in that direction. I told you, but the PCR has to be standardized PCR. It can't be a homegrown lab, every lab having their own primers, no. So that's why the tests that are coming out now are all formed in such a way that a lab technician in a primary health center can do it. So automated PCRs.
So I have a couple of questions. That recently we have this antimicrobial resistance has been very big trouble, and a lot of reports have come that stresses that in 2050 there is going to be a huge crisis and things like that. So I don't know whether we have any perspective from Indian side, because for example TB is definitely clearly identified challenge for India to look into, and in other resistance microbes, have we identified the number of infections or loss due to resistance, and possibly like what are our strategies that we can think to?
Yeah, I think antimicrobial resistance is also a big priority for every country really. And for India, like I was talking about the private sector and, you know, about the vast array of health practitioners, everybody is prescribing whatever antibiotic you can go and buy across the counter and take. So ICMR is, the Ministry of Health now has a national action plan for AMR, which involves many different sectors. It involves also the agriculture, veterinary and animal husbandry sector, because a lot of antibiotics are used as growth promoters in the poultry industry, fish, cattle, etc. So we need to control that, and control, of course, how people are using antibiotics in hospitals. So we have a surveillance network to monitor what's going on in terms of drug resistance for the some key priority pathogens. We also have an antimicrobial stewardship program involving a number of hospitals around the country. So we're trying to put in place some guidelines within hospitals, infection control guidelines, antibiotic prescribing, how hospitals should monitor their own rates. So now there's a growing consciousness and people are trying to implement these things. The Ministry of Health came out with the red line campaign. All antibiotics would have a red line on the cover, so that when somebody buys it, even if you're buying it over the counter, when you see a red line, then you get alerted that this is not a drug you should take without a prescription. So a lot of actions need to be done for AMR, and a lot of it is outside the health sector. Factories that make antibiotics and put their effluents into the water system, the food industry, regulations, strict monitoring of pharmacies so that they don't sell antibiotics over the counter. So a lot of different steps. There is now action. It's a multi-sectoral plan.
There are a lot of interesting technological progress that has happened in the TB detection and also drug treatments. Are we underfunded in TB program in India? And if is it a matter of economics also to scale up the way that we do RNTCP so that the detection is more and the cure rate is there? And finally, if you have like a wish one, what would be the number that we need to invest in to seriously take into the TB eradication?
Yeah, so these things have been worked out, and even globally there are calculations now that you need something like $3 billion for TB R&D over the next so many years, and the investment now is stagnant. So every year there's a report that comes out on TB R&D. It's produced by an NGO called Treatment Action Group. They started off as HIV activists, but they're now a lot more into TB. So they've shown that, you know, the investment in TB R&D globally is plateaued over the many, many years now. It went up, like I said, when HIV was a problem and TB became. So it's far below. I think it's less than a quarter of what is needed. So that's why we are saying countries like India need to step up, because the West is not going to put more money into TB. And so the TB consortium is really hoping that the government would invest a substantial amount into this over the next 5 years. In terms of the RNTCP also, there's a national strategic plan, and the projection is to spend at least 4 to 5 times more than what we're spending currently in order to have that expanded, they've really got a very good plan now. So if you want to do all the components in that plan, you need about 5 times higher budget. So there is a costed plan. Now it needs to be implemented. It has to be done if we have to achieve elimination.
We are like engineering institute, so we have mostly people who probably have a technology that they are in development, and we see that the cycle of these technologies are by the time it takes patient, it needs to be validated by certain set of group clinicians and cohorts that done it in multiple stages. This ecosystem is very much lacking. I mean, there is a good initiative for a TB India program, but in general the biomedical technologies have a very large cycle by the time it reaches a market or patients. We would like that if some actions could be taken on.
Yeah, I think again that's an area where there's a lot of thinking going on now, you know, because a lot of innovations are happening. There's a lot of prototypes that get developed by different groups. How do you take that further? Again, it has to go through certain validation pathways. It has to go through the regulatory system, whether it's a diagnostic or a device. So those pathways are now getting clarified. I think the rules are also being made. So the next few years, I think we'll see, because the government is very keen that innovations, indigenous technologies, etc., should find their way into the public health system, or you know, into, they should be used, not just be as a innovation in a lab. Right now, the main challenge, I think, is in scaling up. Somebody has to put in that investment in order to take a prototype and, you know, make it into a marketable product and then sell it. So there is some risk in that. So that is where we need to think. I think government and the private industry really needs to think together as to how best this can be done. Yeah, so I think that's an interesting question, also a bit complex. So definitely electronic health records is probably the way in which people are going, people are moving in that direction, including the government, ultimately would like all citizens to have an electronic health record. The privacy issue can be addressed by making sure that the access to that electronic health record is something that's controlled by the patient, by the individual. So the individual can give access to whoever he or she decides. And if it's for research, then it should be done with informed consent. And if it's for medical care, of course, then, you know, they're going to share it with their doctor or healthcare provider. But then there's also use of large data sets for analysis, where you're anonymizing patient identifiers and then using the data set to make conclusion, you know, to look at various questions. So that's another way of doing it, where you have to make sure that you're completely anonymizing the data set, that it cannot be linked back to the patient and so on, because in the future there's going to be a lot of implications for insurance and things like that. So, but there are ways of doing that. So I don't think that should be an issue. But I think over the next few years, it'll take time, I think, for this electronic health record thing to really catch on, but it'll happen. But meanwhile, we have a lot of data sets, a lot of surveillance and survey data sets which are available that could be used for analysis that can be easily anonymized.
Thank you.
Anybody else?
How these subclinical TB cases can be traced? Like, is there any?
Those good question.
Are culture
right now,
positive and asymptomatic. Yeah. Suppose I am asymptomatic and if I go for subculture and then I'm getting like positive results, so how I'll come out of this? Like,
right now there's no good way of detecting. So there are only two ways. One is to culture and the other one is to do an X-ray screening. So that in the population based screenings, that's easier to do. You do an X-ray and usually there's an X-ray lesion, you know, maybe something small and may not be causing enough problems for the symptoms. So once you see something on the X-ray, then you can tell that person to go for further testing. So there are now, in fact, machine learning algorithms that are going to be tested very soon, I think, on large data sets to see if they can, computer can read X-rays. So if you're going to screen thousands of people, you can't have radiologists reading those X-rays fast enough. So if you can have machine algorithms to read those X-rays, then you can probably screen large numbers of people fairly rapidly, and then those which are abnormal can go for further evaluation. But I think your question is, right now there's no good answer to that how do you pick up
not
everybody
considered
with
in guidelines also.
It's not there in the guidelines. No.
This is a link to the question that was asked by digitizing the information about patients, etc. So I was amazed that in your data also, while presenting, you said that we don't have a lot of epidemiological data yet, while the West is moving towards sequencing each and every person and then having a centralized database. So realistically speaking, how far behind are we? And when do you see, if I consider a timeline, do you think that the government is taking steps towards this? And if yes, then how long till we reach I mean, with the developing world, with the developed world, sorry.
One area where we're trying to catch up very fast is in detection of drug resistance and giving appropriate treatment, because that is something that we should do for every patient. So if you come with TB, so far the thing was you do your sputum test, and on a smear, you can only say whether it's positive or negative. You start off on some treatment, and then if you're not doing well, then you go for a culture much later, and then you find you have drug resistance, and then it's years before you get on the right treatment. So now we're moving towards offering molecular diagnostics to all TB patients, so that on day zero, you get a proper diagnosis of what kind of TB you have, and you can be on the right. So if you have multi-drug resistant TB, you straight away go on to that treatment, and you don't waste time with this. So there, I think we are moving fairly rapidly. We haven't got there yet where everybody gets a molecular test, but I think we will, I hope, in the next year or two. But otherwise, in terms of looking at the host genomics and, you know, what you call personalized medicine, or trying to see which drug may work better than the other, which one has side, that we're far away. I don't think we're going to go in that direction at all for the medium term. It's more in the research side. I think we need to continue to do those kind of studies, because if you understand more at the population level, then you can try to get better diagnostics. So if there's a particular drug enzyme polymorphism that's particularly common in India, let's say that causes more side effects or that reduces the efficacy of the drug, then we could try and develop a test to detect that. But first is to get that information, that generate that database. So there are now some large-scale genomic studies which are getting underway, which would generate that database. Right now, we don't even have that.
So in your talk, you mentioned that we are making these repositories for TB samples and strains.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it would look intuitive. Why didn't we have them for, you know, a long time? And because TB is a very old disease, and we should have... And the second part is what's the status for other diseases? Like, you know, are we collecting samples and strains for other bacterial diseases and viral, for that matter?
Yeah, why we didn't do all these years is a good question. We didn't organize ourselves properly, I think. It was somebody else asked that question earlier, that each one is doing their own research. We were happy with that, you know. PI initiated. This was an initiative that brought people together. It was NIH, DBT and ICMR really sitting down and having some discussions and saying, this is what we need for the future of TB research. And then we organized ourselves. So we need to do that, I think, for many other diseases as well. And in fact, the Niti Aayog, in their vision document, has talked about this model of the TB consortium and said that it should be done for other diseases. So I think, echoing the point that many of you have made, that we're not well organized as a country to address certain big problems. And Prime Minister often says that the same thing, that why can't our scientists organize ourselves and address some very big scientific questions which affect our own population. So I think we need to, perhaps now I think that everybody is now thinking along those lines. So hopefully we'll see more convergence.
And just to continue to Ravi's point, he talked about resistance in TB, but resistance overall in bacteria is increasing. And a lot of time Western world blames India and China for adding to that. So how much is the truth in that? Are we really responsible for contributing to majority of the resistance? And the second part to it, if it is true, how can we improve our standing internationally?
No, we will contribute to everything in a big way because of our population. So there's nothing where we won't contribute. Per capita use of antibiotics is very high in India. And if you look at some of the Western European countries, they've reduced the per capita use of antibiotics. So I think we need to go in that direction. We overuse antibiotics. For every little thing, we start taking antibiotics. So this is a behavioral thing which has to change. Both the doctors and the patients both have to change. Patients also expect, go to a doctor and you're just told to take paracetamol, you're not happy. You want something more. And then so the patient will go to the next doctor then for another prescription. So I think a lot of awareness creation is needed, and doctors have to be also very rational in the way they prescribe. There's also work going on a diagnostic that can be used to quickly test between a viral and a bacterial. So the main thing is, if you have a viral, you go there to the doctor after 2 days of high fever, you want some relief. The temptation is to take an antibiotic and not wait for 4 or 5 days. So if you had a quick test, a throat swab or some other test that could tell you this is most likely viral, then you would feel more confident waiting and not taking antibiotics. So there are all kinds of prizes now out there for a good diagnostic test, which would distinguish between viral and bacterial. It's a tough thing to do.
So some of it, what I understand from talking to you, could be addressed by, more awareness and increasing scientific aptitude in our society. So as a scientific community, what is it that we can, do and increase and help in the, in this process and reduce?
I think as scientists, we always have to keep talking about the facts and the evidence that exists. And if there are people who come out with irrational claims, then, we need to speak up and say that there's no truth to that, or that those things need to be validated further. So doing research on something is okay. Something new, if somebody's claiming something, you do your research, but don't claim that it has effects which it doesn't have. So I think inculcating the other important one, I think, is that we need to question. So we are not taught to question at all, right? Right from school, you're told to sit quiet and listen. And in fact, if you question the teachers, they get very upset in most places, not in IITs and all. There are, of course, institutions in India which encourage a questioning spirit, but most school, standard schools and colleges would not be encouraging that. And therefore, over a period of time, our students and our children learn not to question anything. And certainly there's also that doctor-patient relationship. You don't question the doctor. And so even if you get a prescription and you're wondering why you've been given those drugs, you may not. So the thing is to start asking why. Of course, now with the internet, a lot of people are able to look up a lot of things on the net. So hopefully that should lead to better awareness. But I think, basically trying to apply, some scientific principles in your day-to-day life is important, and not being afraid to question.
So in addition to infectious diseases, and now we have to, because of this new lifestyle we are getting into, most of us, we have to also think of these lifestyle diseases, diabetes and asthma and hypertension, anxiety and whatnot. And so what are the measures we are taking to, because that will also become a burden in coming decade. So are we forethinking and, thinking something to reduce that burden on society?
That's another whole new lecture. So I think we'll have to have a separate session on non-communicable diseases. But basically you said it, it's a change in lifestyle. And so again, one has to be conscious and aware, because many of these things are preventable by having a healthy, so-called healthy lifestyle. So one has to, it's all behavioral. So it's not easy for government to do something about it, You can educate people again, you can make them aware. And also it's a multi-sectoral thing again. So if you talk about exercise, but if you have no green areas in the city, if you have no parks, if you have no pavements, where do people walk? Where do they exercise? If you want to reduce tobacco, then we have to increase taxes. We have to be very strict on advertising. Foods, now FSSAI, the food safety standards, is being very proactive. So they're looking at labeling of food as healthy or unhealthy. People should start looking at the label to see how much salt and sugar you're consuming during the day. If there are apps now, we are also developing one app where you can feed in what you've eaten for the day, and it will tell you, how much calories, protein, micronutrients you've got. So if you're going to eat one huge big pizza, that's fine, but you should know what you've consumed so that you can compensate by, the next couple of days being careful about you. So it's a lot is about awareness really, and having checkups and, you know, detecting. So now the government says everybody over 30 must have a blood pressure and a blood sugar test done regularly, and they're offering this free screening. And so once early detection is much better, because then you can take the right treatment and make sure you don't get complications. But the risk factors really today for NCDs are high blood pressure and high blood sugar, these two, but also in air pollution, environmental air pollution, and household air pollution still plays a big role in India, and smoking and alcohol, obesity because of high fat, high sugar foods. So we have to pay attention basically to diet and your exercise. Stress, yeah, stress is something that's a little more difficult to deal with. But again, I think, yeah, it's part of the life, so being aware. So the things that can be done at a policy level, at the community level, but then also at the individual level to address this. So that is going to be the challenge for the future. But other countries have shown that they can actually reduce. It doesn't mean that if you keep developing, then your NCDs keep going up. So the US and the UK and all have been able to show a decrease in incidence of cardiovascular diseases and deaths. But for us, it's still going up like that.
Just because, you know, you mentioned that we are not organized and we tend to do work individually, and we have to come together. And a lot of time our projects are also for 3 years, and that's also a limiting factor for researcher, and you have to sometimes change the direction. Hypothetically speaking, we can all come together, and young researchers who have, let's say, 20 to 30 years of life, research life, they can give it to science. So what area would you recommend them to, you know, focus on so that they can address the challenges of future?
I think there are enough areas, so it's really difficult for me to say, you know, this or that. I mean, I come from a medical background, so naturally for me, there are many health priorities which are very important. But there are equally important issues to be addressed in, you know, other areas of life sciences, but also in biotechnology as it applies to agriculture or as it applies to veterinary and livestock. And then there's the whole basic science side, so whether it's physics, mathematics. So I think everybody has their passion and their interest. So we can't dictate to young people that you should work on this or that. But I think the point is that there are several excellent groups that are working on different things. How do we maximize the benefits? Is there a better way to engage, you know, Indian scientists and researchers that are working on related areas or themes, so that there's some convergence and some synergistic effects? So I think that's what we should be looking at. Science is something that's very open, so nobody can really say that, you know, okay, now everybody must start working on this or that problem. We hope more people will work on medical research, especially more doctors. We need more doctors getting into research in a big way, not just clinical research, but also working in the labs on basic science. And that's a big difference we see between the US, let's say, and India. You find very few medically trained people who go into full-time research. So that's certainly a push that ICMR wants to make, to provide more opportunities for medical people and more schemes and more, you know, capacity building efforts to bridge the gap between basic science and clinical. That's something I think we can do in the next few years. But beyond that, I think people have to follow their own passion.
So overall, what would you say is the status of Indian health research? I mean, if you compare internationally, how well are we doing, and how are our projections looking?
As I mentioned, you know, there's a big gap. I think we have to accept that. That we're not, for the size of our country, for all the human resources we have, the smart people we have, the young people we have, we are not producing enough research output as far as at least health research and biomedical is So that's an area of concern, and that's why I was saying that we need to really strengthen research in our medical colleges, as well as make links between medical colleges and science institutions. So this whole concept of clusters or twinning programs, where a basic science institute, say a DBT or a CSIR institute or a ICMR institute, starts working closely with a medical college, and some of the faculty there really who are interested in research start collaborating, that's a good way of getting more medical research going. But ultimately, I hope that many of our medical schools will also become thriving centers of research, of which there are only a handful now.
So you've made the relation between TB and nutrition. So if the people are malnutrition, they tend to be more prone to TB. And there have been always talk of supplementing the diet or rice or some other grain with nutrients. So what are your thoughts on that? Is it a viable option? Do you think it can be subscribed?
Those are studies which are starting now. So the nutrition, because there's been no evidence to date, even though it's very intuitive to think that nutrition supplementation will help, but there have been no big trials which have shown that. So we are now, the ICMR is supporting a couple of studies which have just started. So in the next couple of years, I think we'll get some good information on TB nutrition and also what the interventions could be, what kind of interventions would help.
So in your presentation, you showed there were two deadlines, 2025 or 2035, we are aiming to eliminate TB from India. So what's the realistic, are we going to make it India TB free by 2035?
That's a question I can't answer. We'll have to wait and see. The good thing is that we have this ambitious goal. That's a very first step you need. The country has a goal and an aim. And there is a plan, like I said, there's a national strategic plan. And if we're able to fund it fully and implement it properly, we will eliminate TB. It may not be by 25, but we should be able to get there at some point. But a lot depends on how seriously we take that plan and we implement it. And of course, the new tools, I showed you those graphs. If you don't get those new tools, whether it comes out of Indian research or any other global research, then the entire world's elimination deadline will get further postponed. So it's a lot depends on what comes out of R&D in the next few years.
As far as India is concerned, it is very sad to hear across presentations that we are not there yet as far as even the science and technology is concerned, though our brain is considered to be one of the most brilliant ones. And the West always capitalizes on immigrants, more and more so of now. Why do you think is the government of India not investing enough in science and technology? The percentage of GDP that we invest is really low. And that sort of discourages the young population to be here and do the work here. So are we not, does the government think that the generation is not, are we not good enough, or is it some real situation, the reason why we as a population are not able to convince our governments that this is the way ahead, investment in science and technology?
Yeah, it's not, again, I can't speak on behalf of the government, but I think you're right, traditionally it's been at a lower level. I think we've seen some increases in the last couple of years. Perhaps we'd like much more, at least for health research, I would like to see a much better increase. But we have seen some increases happening, and I think there is potential. There has been some commitment from the government that this will continue to increase. So that's a positive, positive thing. But I think the more, the wider implication of your question is, how much does society value science? So, society can put pressure on governments. It's after all, you saw the People's March for Science in the US drew hundreds of thousands of ordinary citizens onto the street to support science. And when the administration wanted to cut the budget of the NIH, everybody, from senators to ordinary citizens were writing about it and saying that this is not the right thing to do, to cut support to biomedical research. So I think it makes a huge difference when you have society value science, because the government's views are after all a reflection of societies. So probably in the next this generation, I think, can do a lot. This younger generation can do a lot to change people's mindset. Because a lot of it is to do with education and exposure. And having scientific, applying scientific values to your day-to-day life, you know, and principles. So over a period of time, I think it's likely to improve. So I think young people should not be discouraged. I think there's a lot of hope I see that things can only look better the years to come.
The rate at which the government has promised to increase its funding, do you think it is?
Yeah, I think if we keep going at that rate, I think it's good. And we have to also remember that money is not going to solve all our problems, while we definitely need more resources going in. But we also know that some of the biggest discoveries were made with very little resources.
This is one reason that is always given by everyone.
So I think it's, if you have the right, you have to ask the right questions. I think we have to really think very deeply. And many times you see research proposals which are very superficial. Of course, people get very disappointed when their research proposals are not funded. And many times I'm asked, you know, we've applied 2 times, 3 times, we got rejected, we are very dejected about it. So again, I go back to the thinking process. We're not trained. It's the biggest issue, is that we're not trained the way, you know, the Western youngsters are trained through their PhD. When they come out, you know exactly how to write a grant proposal and how to write the research questions and how to write each section of your grant. So I think we need to spend more time on that, and on spending a lot of time in really laying out the questions before we quickly send off a proposal somewhere. So if we start improving the quality, I think we'll also start seeing more investment. So because the government also asks a question that what's coming out of it, what's this investment, what are the returns on the investment and so on. So we need to be able to be fair, we have to answer those questions as well. So if you spent X thousand crores, what did you see at the end of it? Of course, it takes time. You're not going to see it the next year. But let's say if you take a 10-year view and you say this was my investment and this is what I got out of it, then it makes a lot of sense to people, including our parliamentarians. Our parliamentarians often ask this question, that what was the outputs of our research community? So we also have to explain properly. So again, I always say that we are not good communicators, scientists. We are quite content to do our own thing and write our papers and get into a good journal and then we are happy with that. We are not communicating to people what that particular discovery or that advance, what does it mean? Or how does it have any relevance to them? So communication is also an important component, I think, of increasing the society's appreciation for science. Some journalists have started writing now, but not enough. So more scientists need to write.
How is that we can encourage scientists to participate more in communicating science to, you know, society and the policy makers, when they have, you know, the primary responsibility of conducting research and managing everything?
No, but we have very good examples of people who write. Of course, many of them you'll find are maybe more senior people, they're retired, they have some time and they write. But you have younger people also who, some of the best, if you look at people like Atul Gawande or people like Siddharth Mukherjee, they have very successful careers in science or medicine, but they're also writing so much and communicating. And those kind of writings have a huge impact on people.
Can it be a requirement from the funding agency that part of your time, like in UK, they have this requirement, a certain time they demand from the PI, given this grant, you will also participate in
some amount of, I think if that is done, maybe it will help. Like what some agencies do is you have a lay summary of your work that's put on the website, at least people can read it, you know. Not everybody has the skills to write for the common lay media. So you can't force everyone to do that, but science agencies can at least ensure that a one-page summary in lay language, simple language, is available for every grant that's funded. The NIH does that. when your grant is accepted, you have to give them two paragraphs of a lay summary, which people can read. Understand, okay, this is something NIH funded, what is it about?
Women in science. The first question we had, we were like certain, so in our group, we had a good mix of men and women, we're discussing this. So first, I think we want to know, is there a woman, specific woman point of view, and is it any different, you know, because a lot of time we want to celebrate successful women in society and we encourage, but would it be a really a gain having women in power? Do they bring a different perspective, and is this perspective better for society, and can they make the world better?
Yeah, we can either say yes and finish it off there, but I mean, definitely I think the perspectives, you need to have an equal number of men and women in science, especially in leadership positions, because right now you have very unequal distribution. So I think there's no doubt that having women in the room definitely makes a difference in the way you think. But I mean, we can't generalize, you know, we can't say that all women are sensitive, empathetic, you know, have a different point of view, would be more intuitive. Broadly speaking, maybe, but not necessarily so. You can have men who have the same qualities, and you may have women who don't have those qualities. But I think looking at the number of men and women entering into science is almost now, you know, pretty well balanced. But as you go higher and higher up, you find that fall off. And if you look at directors of institutions and above, you'll find very few women in those positions. So that's something we need to change. And personally, I never thought of myself as a woman scientist or as a woman physician, researcher, and therefore I'm doing certain things. No. You were doing it because you had that passion, you wanted to do work in a particular area, and so you kept doing it. So what drives you, I think, is probably similar in men and women. It's nothing different. The challenge, of course, comes is that you are expected to have more responsibilities in the household at different stages of your life. And so then that's where the balancing act comes. How do you balance that? Because still I think women do have more household responsibility, whether it's child rearing or whether it's caring for family members. There is a disproportionate burden on the woman in most situations. So that's where the challenge really comes. That's where you need a supportive environment at home.
But in addition to support from home, can our institutes and you know, society help?
Yeah, I mean,
and not make a for a woman, you know, the choice between career and family, because a lot of time that's what happens after 30 with a lot of women.
So now there are schemes, you know, for flexi, for coming back to your career after a gap and things like that. But also I think things like childcare at work, creches, those kind of things probably we need to do much more of, so that it becomes much easier for women to do both. Make sure their child is being well looked after so that they can concentrate on work and not necessarily have to take off. So there are things like that which could be done, definitely, to make life easier. But I think also sharing responsibilities, I think now with this generation, should be much more possible, I think, to share responsibilities between the man and the woman in the family. At least try to bring some balance over there.
So my next question was kind of handed over to me by a faculty member, and she said, I need to communicate to you. So several times women who are in power, and their number is less. So even a meeting, board meeting, is generally one woman in 10 men. And the general feeling is that the voice is not heard as effectively as other colleague of theirs, even though they are, you know, gathered together for same cause. So in a situation like that, what a woman can do? I mean, she made it there, but now how to be effective?
No, but then you have to speak up. Once you're there in the room, you have to say what you know, you need to say it. Sometimes intimidating, to do that, but then you get used to this kind of situation where you, after that you don't even notice after some time that everybody else in the room is a man, you know. So little bit aggressiveness I think one has to cultivate. And there again it's a double-edged, because if you're aggressive then everybody says, you know, she's such an aggressive thing, and that's how she got to where she is, or they'll say, you know, is she a woman or a man, and you'll hear all those kind of comments from others. But there is, I think, a way of putting your viewpoint without necessarily being abrasive or aggressive. You have to be firm. But I think once you're there in that responsible position, then you need to speak up.
And also, I think the similar is seen when subordinates, male subordinates, don't, respect or don't take your authority as well as they would take from a male counterpart. And that also becomes an issue. And so do you think that can also be dealt by being, you know, more...
I think those are leadership skills you learn as you go along. How to manage people in large organizations. So somebody said to me once that if you're in that position right at the top, most of the time you need counseling skills. You don't need other kind of, because you'll have all these people coming to you with complaints and fighting and all that. So half the time you're sorting out all those things. So you need a lot of different skills to be a leader. And in fact, it's not your scientific knowledge or your skills that's going to matter the most, whether you're an effective leader or not. It's all your other management skills, people management skills. No, as you said, this is a societal thing, so it will take some time to change. The men also have to, I think, have different expectations of women. Families also, you know, so very often after marriage, then, you know, it's the husband or the husband's family who will say, no, you know, give up your career for a bit. Stay at home and have your family and things like that. So again, I think it's an individual thing, and it's between the partners really to figure that out. There's no prescription there. But it's again a recognition, I think, that both the careers are equally important. And so there's give and take. If you see in the West, I've seen so many of my own nieces and nephews and all that, you know, one will be working to support the other one while they're doing the PhD, and then this one gives up and then the other one does a PhD and things like that, and childcare and all that managed somehow. So I think both men and women have to give more weightage and importance to the career of the woman, which is as important as the career of the man. And if they both say that, then their families can be made to understand.
Do you think you would be more successful if you were a man?
How more successful do you want to be?
Probably the head of NIH or something like that.
NIH has never had a woman head. At least the ICMR has at least had two,
yeah.
You know. So yeah, the glass ceiling there is same if not worse, as bad if not worse. Would I have been more successful as a man? I don't think so. Like I said, for me, I never, even when I became DG, somebody said, oh, the first woman, second woman and all that, how do you feel? I said, well, I hope it's not because of that. One doesn't want to be told now you're a woman and therefore you've got selected as a DG, you know. So obviously you want to be judged by exactly the same benchmark, yeah, and the yardstick. So we don't want any special considerations for being a woman scientist. Scientist has to be good. In their own, you have to be judged on your work, not on anything else. So, and also I think in life sciences, especially in medicine, you don't have that stark difference that you have in other scientific disciplines like computers, maybe like math or physics, where you have a big disparity. So in medicine, we have a lot of women. And even in research, ICMR, about a third are women. I think the ratio is better than the other science agencies. So I, like I said, never thought about the fact that I was a woman or what was different. One, of course, had to juggle all the other family and household things. But perhaps that's where the supportive family made a difference, husband particularly.
So first, answer to first part of Nimi's question, is it a dream job? Do you have a dream job? I think
it is.
There's truth to that.
Yeah, I think it is.
From this position, it looks like.
You can do a lot. Basically, in a position like this, you can contribute. So that's the main attraction of this position. I mean, there are a lot of things which are very, you know, you have to do it, administration and all those other kind of things. But I think if you can, like I said, my dream is to really, really strengthen a biomedical research capacity in the country. So you do have opportunities when you're at this level to do things which you can't do otherwise.
Was this always your dream? I mean,
no,
you
no.
plan it like that?
Wasn't planned at all.
When we have indigenous technologies that's being developed, when you go to the doctors and other places where you want to sell, the first ask is it a FDA validator or a CE marked devices? So the reason is that the confidence level that we have in our own technologies are minimum because of the process that we take to evaluate and approve them. And it's just a wish statement that a lot of technologies needed to be accelerated and pushed and with a good standard that we can be proud of. So any suggestions on this?
No, I think I said earlier that the regulatory environment is undergoing a change exactly to address this question. And now there have already been changes in the rules where indigenous technology would be given some advantages, in the sense you will not be asked to produce all those foreign those CE marks and things, and also that you don't have to have proof of having sold to so many people before. So those kind of things are happening. But yeah, obviously I think there is some way to go. There is some way to go, and we need a pathway and we need a proper system to make sure that these kind of things are going through the pipeline. And thank you.